So what we have done till now is you start with a formula, then rectify it. After rectification, pull the quantifiers to the beginning. Okay, then use Skolemization, right? Then after Skolemization, all the existential quantifiers are removed. Then all that you have only possibly some universal quantifiers in the beginning. That is called the prefix of the formula, the block of quantifiers. Then you have the matrix of the formula which is having no quantifiers. Then convert the matrix to one CNF, right? So you reach at SCNF, Skolem conjunctive normal form. Fine. Then we wanted to discuss something more on the SCNFs. So now let's take one example. Start with that. See, I have a simple formula PAB. Okay. So this is in SCNF. It looks very trivial, but let's see. This will tell us what to do. So this is in SCNF. Fine. There is no quantifier at all. Now question is, the SCNF is a form which preserves only satisfiability of the formula. If x was originally satisfiable, then its SCNF is also satisfiable, and conversely. Fine. Suppose this is the formula and this is also its SCNF. So now, to say that it is satisfiable, what are we going to do? So obviously, demands of a model. If there is a model, it is a sentence also. So all these SCNFs are sentences. So we need not consider the valuations at all, right? We can think of only interpretations, where there is a domain and there is one map which assigns the predicates and function symbols to predicates and functions on the domain. Fine. So now this formula, to say that it is satisfiable, what we will do? We can think of any domain where these two constants a and b will be interpreted as elements of the domain, and p will be interpreted as a binary relation, right? Suppose you take natural numbers. So you say a means it is 2, b is 3, and p means less than. So now you have got a model, right? But so many other models can be there. In fact, there are so many possibilities, we do not know which one to choose. There are infinitely many possibilities. Any set you can choose and then try to define any relation and assign these constants to any elements in that domain, right? So choice is too much, we do not know how to make it mechanical. But there is a natural way to go for this mechanical model construction. So what we do? We have this A and B. Let me take only two elements set, say A prime, B prime. So here implicitly I am taking that A is assigned to A prime, B is assigned to B prime in my domain D. Okay. Then how to reach this P? I have only occurrence of PAB. So I will write my P prime as the set containing only ordered pair A prime, B prime. That is all. It is a model of this. Right. So now comes the thing that why to take this A prime, B prime, why not just AB? There are also symbols, because in this set it is not a concrete set like 1, 2 and so on, having no definite properties. So I can just as well take AB, forgetting this prime, and then my P will be AB ordered pair. Now why to assign even AB ordered pair? I just declared PAB is true. Okay, so I just get a model. So that means given P A B, I just think of A as an element of the domain, B as an element of the domain, where P A B is true, right? But this always we may not be able to do, because we cannot just say the whatever formula is there, it is true. Its structure is so that it need not be true. Like for example, P A B and not P A B. So whatever A B I choose, I can never make it true, right? But I can always declare the atomic formulas to be true or false, not necessarily with connectives. That much can be done, right? Okay, let's take one more example before proceeding. Say I have P X A. So now, how to consider a model? Well, this means for each X P X A, once it is in SCNF, we have taken away all the quantifiers. They are all universally quantified now, all the free variables. So this will say for each x p x a. Now if you want to have a model or a domain where it is an infinite set, then you have to give p every element, then a whatever is assigned, all those should be true. But who asks you to take infinite? You can take also finite. I can start with a itself, right? So only one element in my domain a, and then I declare that a is having only in p, that will make it a model, right? This will be really p prime, this is a prime, and so on. You are now forgetting those primes, fine. So easily you can make. Now suppose it is p a f of a. Now how far we can go without constructing one domain, right? Well, you can think of one element a where f of a is also equal to a, right? Then you can have p as the single pair a a, that is fine, that is allowed, right? But suppose I have p a f a and a is not equal to f of a, right? Then I cannot take this f of a equal to a, because equality predicate has to be interpreted as equality in strings or equality in the domain, whatever is the domain. Now when we do not have any definite domain, we are just taking the symbols a, or only equality there is equality as strings, they are just formal symbols, right? So now I cannot take f a equal to a, as strings they are different, so I cannot say a is equal to f a. Then what to do? Take another b, okay? Now you define f of a equal to b, that is fine, no problem. So just define f of a equal to b, that gives a model, so p has to be changed and this will be b, and then a is not equal to b in this domain, fine. So that gives a model, is that clear? But always that also may not succeed, because suppose I have p x f of x. Now suppose you start with a in your domain, now it needs another which is f of this, say along with this I have not of x equal to f of x, right? So we will have in p at least a and b, so I give b, and then we have to define f of a equal to b, right? But this should be true for every x in the domain, right? So what should be there? Again for b I have to define something, so I say define f of b equal to c, so I give b c. Now it becomes infinite, right? F of b equal to a, you can put, yes, why not? Negation of x equal to f x, so a is not equal to f of a, then b is not equal to f of b, that is clear, right? But f of a can be equal to a, that does not put any restriction, so still it can be done, right? But there is a problem, we are now varying this b, they are no more looking like strings as per our convention here. For a we are just writing as a, now for f of a we should write f of a, not b, right? So if you proceed that way, what do you get? You will be getting one infinite set, because equality will be by equality of strings only, in that sense no more equality you will be defining, right? So if that is our proposal, then it will end up in an infinite set, it will not stop, yes. See, here when we take that, we will not write these primes but consider them as elements, so that means a is considered as a itself, b is considered as b itself. Now when you come to a f a, we will be taking a as a itself, but we are not going to define f of a equal to b anymore. We are taking f of a itself, right. So, instead of f of a written as b, we will be taking f of a itself. Once you do that, you cannot write f of a will be equal to a again. They will be different as strings, right. So, that will end up in one infinite sets, right. But then what is the advantage in doing this? It may be possible, always I will be able to do this, right. But again, suppose I have the formula and x is not equal to f of x, then this will again take another element. So, in general you may not be able to get always this finite model, and there are in fact formulas for which there exist no finite models, only on infinite sets they will be true, right. So, in those cases this kind of model building will fail, fine. We have to go back to our earlier scheme, that instead of taking it as b, let us write it as f of a, ok. So, in that case, for example, this even p a f a, we would build a domain as a f of a and we can stop there, right, and then declare that p will be equal to a and f a ordered pair only, nothing else, they are related by p, that is all, right. In case of p x or even p a f of a and a is not equal to f of a, ok. In this case what should we do? I cannot take a f a, but a f a will do, a is not equal to f of a still. So, again the same domain works, fine. If it is p x f of x and x is not equal to f of x, then there might be problem, right. I may start with a, so a does not occur in the formula, right. So, let me give some other name instead of a, call it eta. I just start with some symbol eta, then I need f of eta, right. But to make this true, I need f of eta as x and this becomes f of eta, right. So, I need another element f of eta. Again, by taking f of eta here, I need f of eta, right. So, I put that again and now it continues, it becomes an infinite set, fine. We can take the infinite set.
A comma
f, we say
that f of a is not equal to a,
but
shouldn't we define f,
or
is it necessary?
We are not even defining it, as strings they are not equal.
Yeah, strings they are not equal, but
right.
Okay, so it
doesn't, okay. But it raises another question, which says suppose instead of not equal to, we have equal to, what will you do? Do you see the problem? Not equal to is already satisfied because as strings they are not equal, fine. But now when you have equality relation, say p x f of x and x is equal to f of x, ok. I can have the same domain again, eta f of eta and so on. Now, how to tackle this x is equal to f of x? So, for p I can define as it is p of all x f x, so that x belongs to this, then that will be my set. Now, for equality I cannot write x equal to f of x because the strings they are not really equal. So, equality relation has to be tackled separately, it is not just writing p something, right. All these p's can be interpreted later, we can give them 0 or 1 for each of the elements in this domain, formal domain. I can declare p of eta is 1, p of eta is 1, declare them, all the others you take them 0, fine. But then what about the equality? We have to do something here, equality cannot be just the equality of strings, that is what it says.
So, here we are doing it sort of syntactically in there, we have to find a semantic.
You have to do something there. It's not exactly the string equality. So you have to give another definition of equality there. Right? It is not just the string equality there. Some other equality will do. But what equality will be appropriate in this syntactic domain? Right? It is a syntactic domain now. Right? You are just formally making the domain without giving any structure, without bringing any set, no numbers, no patterns are there. Only except generated from the terms, generated from the function symbols. Okay. So we have to find out what properties of equality we are interested in. That will give us a definition of semantic equivalent of equality in this formal domain. Right. So since it is equality relation which was preserved for equality in the domain semantically, we need some properties of equality relation on the domain, semantic equality. Right. Which we are writing as equal to. This is really semantic. So some properties of this we need, which we are interested in. Right. So first thing is, whatever is that relation, let us call that E. Suppose this is related to, as interpreted as relation E. It is a binary predicate, so E also will be a binary predicate. Okay. It is a binary predicate. Now, this E will have some properties of equality, not all. If all, then it will be that string equality which is not possible. Okay. So which properties we are interested in? First thing is, we may take that as it is an equivalence relation, because equality is an equivalence relation. It is reflexive, symmetric and transitive, that much should be there. Right. So other thing we need is substitutivity. Right. Suppose in a term you substitute one equal to another. So S is there occurring, T is also occurring, and S is equal to T. That is what you have to find, you will find in the formula that S equal to T occurs. Right. Then you should be able to substitute S for T, and its valuation latter should be same. Is it clear what I am telling? Suppose F is a function, unary function, where S is occurring, and you have a formula S equal to T. Okay. Then f of s is assigned by phi to some element, say d. Then also with the same phi you should get f of t equal to d. That property we need. Right. Now this equality we are not having anymore. There is no domain here. Right. So all that we can say that these two elements should be related by this e. Right. If S and T are related by this E, then these two also should be related by E. That is the substitutivity property in terms. Okay, let's write it down. So for the equality relation, we are now writing this E. So E is a binary relation satisfying some properties. So these are the properties it will satisfy. First is, E is an equivalence relation. Okay. So now the question is, what is the domain of this E? We have not specified it formally, but we have explained enough. So that will start from this syntactic domain, where you start from all the constants in the formula. If no constant is there, then write some eta. Then if there are functions, you generate all terms from this using the functions. Right? That is your domain. So let's write it formally if you are not getting it. Let x be a formula in Sculam form, or let us say SCNF. Okay. So now we are going to define a domain D. let us give it a name, it is called a Hermitian domain. Hermitian domain of X is defined by we should give some name, right? Say it is dx. So dx contains all constants occurring in X. That is the first rule we should have. We should start from the constants. They will be interpreted as themselves. Okay. Second, if f is a function symbol of arity n occurring in A in the formula X, and say t1 to tn are terms in dx, then f of t1 to tn belongs to dx. So, it should be closed under taking function symbols, right, forming the terms. Then third thing is, it can be anything satisfying these two. We do not want that. We want it to be minimal, nothing else is there, right. It contains only this kind of terms. So, dx is minimal. Satisfying 1 and 2. So, this is our domain we are considering. Okay. So, now one question is, if dx does not any constant, that is possible, right? In that case, we start from eta, so that we have to specify there. Okay. If no constants occur, if none in X, then dx contains eta, some symbol we are using, let us call it eta. So, that means you will be starting the domain from the constants. So, what you do is take d 0 equal to the set of constants occurring in X. d1 equal to d0 if d0 is non-empty, otherwise it is eta. Okay. When d0 is empty, we just start with eta. Then di+1 equal to, let me say di union f of t1 to tn. Such that t1 to tn belongs to di and f occurs in X. Okay. Then your dx will be equal to union of all these di's. You do not need to take d0 anyway, you can just write I belongs to z+. There is no harm in taking d0 also, right? It is contained in d1. So, that is how you will be proceeding to get your domain, fine. In that domain only we are considering this equivalence relation. So, our interpretation, our model, what we are going to construct will be on this domain D. Sometimes we just write D instead of D sub X, if X is clear from the context. So, now this E is a relation, binary relation on D, or let us write dx. Once a formula x is there, it will be dx on the Hermitian domain D. Sometimes that is also written as H sub D instead of dx. Okay, so it is an equivalence relation. Second is that should be substitutivity property for the terms. So we'll write that if S, comma T belongs to E, then so that means S is equal to T. That is our sense of interpretation here, right? So if S and T are related by this equivalence relation, S T belongs to E, then now we need also terms. Okay, we may write for each term. There is no problem. Then for each T 1 to say T I minus 1 T I plus 1 to T n and NRE function f, we may say occurring in x because they are the terms only in D. F of T 1 to T I minus 1 S T I plus 1 to T n should be equal to F of T 1 to T I minus 1 T T I plus 1 to T n. So that means this ordered pair must be in E, right. So that gives the substitutivity property in terms. Once S is equal to T, you can substitute and say that this term is equal to this term. In fact, that equal to will be in the domain, in the interpretation sense. Whatever element this is assigned to will be assigned to this also. Now we have the domain itself, so we just write this is belong to E. Okay. One more we need, which is for the predicates. We can't write predicate ordered pair of the predicates belong to E. Either a predicate will become true or it is false, right, by the interpretation. So what we do, we write similar thing but now with truth or falsity. If S T belong to E, then for each T 1 to T I minus 1 T I plus 1 to T n, which are terms. So these are in D and P and NRE predicate occurring in X. What we have is P of this T 1 to T I minus 1 S T I plus 1 to T n is true if and only if P of T 1 to T I minus 1 T T I plus 1 to T n is true. Even you can write if then, that is enough because it is an equivalence relation, right. So S for T or T for S, it does not matter. Okay. So this must hold. These are the only properties of E we have. We don't need equality, but at least one binary predicate which will behave this way. That will be our analogy for equal to. So now, what one Hermite interpretation will do? We want to interpret, right? We have a domain. Now all the predicates are just written like relations. They are remaining with the same symbol, but we are now thinking them as if they are relations, not predicates. All functions give rise to terms. In fact, they are closed terms only. After they are evaluated, they will give rise to terms. So they remain as functions themselves. The same symbols are used. Fine. Then what else we need for the interpretation? We should tell when some atomic formulas are true, when they are false. That much only we need, right? So the phi, the second component phi, need not be specified for anything else. Only it can say when a one atomic proposition is true, when it is false. Once it says this much, all the other things taken care by the connectives, right. So that means one Hermite interpretation will be an ordered pair, where D is this the domain, and there is one component phi. That phi we need not specify for how the predicates are interpreted, how the functions are interpreted. We only need to specify how it assigns 0 or 1 to the atomic formulas, right. So the atomic formulas here will be of the form P of T 1 to T n, where T 1 to T n are closed terms, there is no variable in that, right. So in this sense, these atomic terms are called ground terms, and these atomic formulas what we are getting are called ground atomic formulas. Along with their negations, they are called ground literals. So everywhere one ground is added as an adjective there. Okay. So now what do we do is just define the Hermite interpretation. Hermite interpretation is an ordered pair which is D phi. So in fact, we are not defining a Hermite interpretation in general, we are defining a Hermite interpretation for a formula x, right. So this D is really dx, once x is in the context this D will be dx. Then this phi, where phi of any p of any t 1 to t n is either 0 or 1, it fixes in some way, right. So phi fixes this to 0 or 1, something it fixes. Once it is fixed, your Hermite interpretation is fixed, right. We will see an example how this goes. Let us see some simple example we should start with. Say not p x f of x and say p y a, let us start with this, that is our x. Now our Hermite domain which is d x will write as a only, but there is a function symbol f, it starts from a, right. So now your d 0 is having a, then d 1 will have f of a along with a, d 2 will have a f of a, f of f of a, right. So it continues, once a function symbol is there it will be infinite. So we take a f of a and so on, that is our Hermite domain. Okay. So what is Hermite map phi? So we will call this as a Hermite map, which is fixing in the Hermite interpretation. So the Hermite map phi, let us fix it this way. See, we cannot do it as it is because you have to go for the ground instances, right. When you put these ground terms there, what formulas you are getting? Here it is easy to see, it will tell p a f of a, p f of a, f of a, f of a, and so on. In general p f n minus 1 a f n a, it looks like that. So to all those things we have to specify how this phi behaves, right. And also you have to say p any y from this a, how that also behaves, right. Suppose you want to make a Hermite model which will satisfy all these formulas, then both this must be true at the same time. So this must be true at least, this will be false, right, p x f x will be false, p y a should be true. Now if p of y a is true, we have to write p s a equal to 1, where s varies from anything, right. So let us define that way, say p s a equal to 1 for each s in d x. All other things we can take to be 0, does not matter, and one among them will be this of these forms. So let us write phi of p s t equal to 0 for s in d x and t not equal to a, of course t belongs to d x, okay. So suppose you define like this. Now is it a model? You have constructed for that purpose only. Okay, we have to see whether it is a model or not. Now when you come to this formula, it is for each x, for each y, the whole thing. That is the really formula, right? Because x and y are free variables, they are omitted from the SCNF, so they are really universally quantified. Fine. So now SCNF we have taken because it can distribute over the AND. Fine. So this will be really equivalent to for each x, not for not p x f x, and for each y p y a. This is the formula at hand. Now we claim that this d phi is a model of this. That is our claim. We want to verify, right? So now we will be going for first formula. Let us say for each x, not p x f x, whether that is true or false. Okay. So this is same thing as telling not there is x p x f x. Okay. So this will be true when you find one element from your domain such that p x f x is false. Right. For example, take a. So now we see that p a f of a is evaluated to 0, is false, since phi of p a f a in our definition equal to 0. That is our definition. Whatever t is, if it is not equal to a, it will be 0. So it is 0. So once this is 0, it says there exists one x which is equal to a in our domain such that p a f a is false. So not of that will be true, right? So first formula is true. Second one, for each y p y a, so that means we should have p a p f of a p f of a, all these should be true, okay? And that is true because p s a equal to 1 for each s in dx. Right, so we have got a Herbian model. Okay, so therefore, d x and phi is a Herbian model of x. Fine. So this is the reason Herbrand is called the first computer scientist. He made it mechanical almost, even for the first order logic. How mechanically we should proceed to show that some first order formula is satisfiable. Okay, we don't have to consider any domain now, just proceed formally. Okay, this also gives rise to another thing. Let's see in that example what is happening. See, I have these terms in dx, f of a and so on, all these ground terms. Now what we do, we just substitute in place of variables all these terms and get some formulas, right. So if there are infinite number of terms here, we will get infinite number of formulas from x itself, right. So that means substituting the free variables by the terms from dx, ground terms, we get the ground instances of the formula x, right. They are called the ground instances. The set of all ground instances, if you take, that is called the Herbrand expansion. So, it is the Herbrand expansion of x. Let us compute that Herbrand expansion. So, here we may define it Herbrand expansion of x is, let us write H e of x, which is equal to the set of all x where x 1 substituted by t 1, x n substituted by t n, such that t 1 to t n are in d x, x 1 to x n are all free variables. All later we write this way. This is the set of all free variables of x. This is the Herbert expansion. Okay. So each one of these element in the Herbert expansion is called a ground instance of x. So now look at the Herbert expansion of that formula x in our example. Now here to get the Herbert expansion, what I do is first I substitute x as a, right, and similarly y as a. X and y can vary over the whole domain D now. So first I get not p a f of a and p a. Okay. Suppose I keep that a x and vary this y. I must get everything, right? So vary this y. That will give not p a f of a and p f of a a. Next, not p a f of a and p f of a that continues varying this y, right. So next I will have varying x again, not p f of a f of a and p a a, not p f of a and p f of a, right, that again continues. So same way it continues. I find an infinite set, that is its Herbert expansion. All possibilities for x and y you substitute, get the ground instances, set up all those ground instances is the Herbert expansion, right. Now what this suggests is that whatever model you have chosen, phi of p s a equal to 1, phi of p s t equal to 0, this way, right. The same thing thought as a propositional assignment, right. They are now just propositions, there are no quantifiers, nothing is there, atomic propositions you can think of them. Now for this atomic things, if I think of this as a PL interpretation, propositional logic interpretation, then the same thing should be a model of the Herbert expansion. Because that is what basically we are doing, right. Is it true or not? Just verify in this case. So here it says p s a equal to 1 for each s in dx. So that is p a is 1, p a is 1 and p f a is 1, p f of a is 1. So all these and things everywhere, they are 1, they are true now. Okay. Next thing it says p s t equal to 0 for t not equal to a. So not p s t equal to 1 for t not equal to a, not p s t equal to 1, whatever s t may be, t should not be a. So if t is not a, they are all 1 everywhere, t is not a, right. So the whole set is satisfied now. So the same phi satisfies h e. So you see that phi is a model of h e. This is a propositional model now, right. It propositionally satisfies h e, fine. So what Herbert did it, that a first order formula is satisfiable if and only if some infinite set of, possibly an infinite set of propositions is satisfiable, that is the contribution. Okay. So you can reduce first order satisfiability to propositional satisfiability. Just we have to check propositional satisfiability here, but it might end up in an infinite formula. Okay, that's it, and that is very clear. Of course, once you take any particular domain, there it is clear. In that domain, you substitute all those things, satisfy for the relations, whether they satisfy the relations or not. That is again propositional. But what it did is, you don't have to search for any domain. You just confine yourself to the Hermite domain. That is enough. Is that clear? But you have to give a proof of this really, that HE is propositionally satisfiable if and only if X is having a model, having a Hermite model. Then you have to show X is satisfiable if and only if X has a Hermite model. So two things we have to see here, right? X is satisfiable if and only if it has a Hermite model, if and only if its Hermite expansion is propositionally satisfiable. Right. Let's see another example. I have just changed a bit there, huh? It should be easy to do. So here our dx is equal to say A, same dx, but we have a B, right? So you may have B. And so on, but there is no A here, so instead of A we have B. It is not another. And so, okay. Earlier there was A, there is no A now. Only B is there. So from B it will start. It will look like this. Then what is its Hermite expansion? We just have to substitute x and y in place of this, right? Or substitute x and y for these terms, ground terms. So we get P B f of B and not P B B. P B f of B and not P B f of B. Right? And then it continues P f of B f of B and not P B B. Again it continues, right? This is Hermite expansion. Okay. Now you see that it is not satisfiable immediately. Because second ground instance, that ground instance is not satisfiable. So this is not satisfiable, right? Because of this, which is unsatisfiable. Now you can show easily that this is also unsatisfiable. Can you see or not? You take any domain, B is interpreted as something, call it B prime. Okay, F is interpreted as some F prime, so call it F prime of B prime instead of F of X, F of B. Then you just instantiate this. It is for each X, for each Y, everywhere it should be true, but for that B and F B it is not true. Therefore, it is unsatisfiable. Right? So the proof becomes also simple because of the Hermite expansion. We can really prove how it is unsatisfiable easily. Okay, so the whole structure is seen now quickly once you have the Hermite expansion for this. Is it clear? So this is what we are going to see next, that a formula is satisfiable if and only if it has a Hermite model, if and only if its Hermite expansion is satisfiable.